Hello, am I live? I think I'm live. All right. Hey, how's it going? Grayson and Houston Church. This is the Late Riser Service. Welcome. Welcome, you guys. So, how's y'all's week been? Good. I have some people in the seats. It's going to be a good day. Say hey.
Hey.
Hey. Yeah, look at that. Look at that. So, I hope everything's going great in your life today. I just want you to let you know you're blessed, you're loved, you're highly favored, and you're righteous because of Christ. All because of Jesus, all because of the work at the cross. Remember, it's nothing about we do that got us righteousness, so we can't do anything to get out of righteousness because it's not based on our performance or obedience, it's based on Christ. Thank you, Jesus, for that. Amen. And that's what to be righteous by faith means. Okay, so let's first go to Romans chapter 10. Okay, Romans 10. Verse 3. Let me get there myself. So that's Romans 10, verse 3 and 4. And it says, For they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. What does this mean? So, what Paul's writing here, he's writing to the Jewish people, but he's saying that whenever you're seeking to establish your own righteousness, like, oh, I'm going to be blessed because look, I just watched Joseph Prince 10 times today. I'm going to be so highly favored. But you just made it about your performance that you're trying to be righteous instead of seeing that it's a gift of righteousness. Yeah. The gift of righteousness is faith. Faith is looking to Jesus. Faith, it's righteousness of faith. So let's keep going. So Moses, verse 4, for Christ is the end of the law and righteousness to everyone who believes. The end of the law. The end. No more law. No more accusation. No more, oh, I do good, I get good. No more, I do bad, I get bad. No, he did good, you get good. Amen? Amen. And remember, church is not a place for perfect people. It's a place for imperfect people. It's a place where, you know what, the imperfect people, we get together and we learn about how perfect Jesus is. Amen. And how perfect our Savior is and how perfect his work was and how perfect he's making our lives. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Amen. So for Christ is the end of the law, righteousness to everyone who believes. For Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law, which the man who does them shall live by them. So if you're living your life according to this system that I do good or I do this bad, I get bad. Oh, howdy, how's it going? Nice to see you guys. Oh, howdy, howdy, howdy.
How are you?
Good. Okay, so righteousness by faith. All righteousness by faith. So howdy, howdy.
Sorry we're late.
No, it's all fine, it's all good. So no more people just walked in. So,
thank you.
All right, nice to see you guys. So, I'll just restart. We're in Romans chapter 10. Romans 10, verse 3. So I was saying that it says, for they being ignorant of God's righteousness and seeking to establish their own righteousness have not submitted to the righteousness of God. Whenever this was written, Paul was writing to the people that to say that, you know what? Hey, it's not about your righteousness, because whenever we start living on the premises that, oh, I do good, look at me, I just did all these good things, God's going to bless me because of what I'm doing. See, that's what the law means. We're not under that covenant anymore. We're under the covenant of grace that Jesus did the perfect work at the cross. He finished it. He made you righteous by faith. And that you get everything you don't deserve. You get what you don't deserve. Okay? So it says, for Christ is the end of the law, for righteousness to everyone who believes. Because righteousness is a gift. It's the gift of righteousness. Whenever you believe that one time, say, Jesus, you're my Savior. Thank you. I need you to save me. You get the gift of righteousness. Gift. Amen. And whatever it's been given to you can never be taken. It can never go out because you didn't do anything good to get it. You just received it. It was a gift. Amen. So your performance does not disqualify you from righteousness because you didn't do anything to qualify for righteousness.
Amen.
Because Jesus paid the price at the cross. You received it as a gift. So this gift. And as I was saying, you know, church is not a place for perfect people. It's a place for imperfect people.
Amen.
That have a perfect Savior, Jesus Christ. He's perfect. And you know what? He did everything perfect at the cross.
He paid for all of our sin. He paid for all of our condemnation. He took all of ours and paid for it to make us righteous. Okay? So as I was saying, verse 5. For Moses writes about the righteousness which is of the law. The man who does them shall live by them. So the law came through Moses. Grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Amen. The law, what came through Moses?
Law, the Ten Commandments.
The Ten Commandments. What is the Ten Commandments? It's you shall not, you shall not, you shall not. It's all based on your performance. Yeah. It's all based on you.
Right.
See, that's the old covenant. Now, since we have the new covenant, Jesus, he removed the ten to give you, hey, I did good. I did good so that you can receive all the goodness that you don't deserve.
Amen.
Amen? You don't deserve. We deserve the cross, but Jesus took our place so that we can get what we don't deserve. All of his goodness, his righteousness, his blessings, his favor, his abundantly good favor.
Amen.
Amen. And then it says right here, but the righteousness of faith speaks in this way. Righteousness of faith speaks, okay? Righteousness of faith speaks. What is the righteousness if I'm trying to do right, do good to get God's favor? That's me seeking to establish my own righteousness. So I'm not submitting to God's righteousness of faith. And you know what? Righteousness of faith speaks. I am the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's what we say. Keep on saying that. That is believing, because I believe, therefore I spoke. That's what David said in Romans 4. So, as I was saying, we're going to go over to Isaiah 55. Isaiah 55. I just want to kind of do a little groundwork for righteousness by faith instead of righteousness by doing good. You're righteous because of Jesus, and he loves you, and you're blessed.
Amen.
Amen.
Yeah.
And it even says in Ephesians that you've been blessed with every blessing in heaven because of Christ Jesus.
Amen.
So,
amen.
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 Amen. And what is grace, class? Grace is
undeserved, unmerited favor from God.
Undeserved, yeah. Unearned, unmerited favor from God. It's something we can't get from doing good. It's something we get because he did good.
Amen.
It's something that Jesus gives us freely because of his work at the cross. Amen?
Amen.
So Isaiah 54. So if you've ever read Isaiah 53, it's all about the sufferings of Jesus on the cross. It says that he has borne our griefs and our sorrows. That griefs in the Hebrew is actually sicknesses. The word sorrows is actually physical pains. It even says that, you know, that God crushed him at the cross. By his stripes we are healed. That's all in Isaiah 53. It's all about the sufferings of Jesus on the cross. It's a prophecy.
Amen.
But what's the first word of Isaiah 54? What is it?
Sing.
Sing. That's right, because you know what? The cross is past. Judgment, all the judgment that we deserve, fell on Jesus at the cross.
Amen.
So now that we're believers now, we sing, O barren. It says sing, sing. Singing is joyful.
Amen.
You know what? Because you know now what? We're going to be judged because of our performance. We're not going to be judged based on what we've done wrong. The condemnation is no longer for you because Christ has taken it at the cross.
Amen.
Amen. And I talk a lot about the cross because that is the finished work of Jesus. He did it all.
Amen.
He did it all for us. And he's our Savior. Actually, the word Jesus means to save. It means salvation. His name actually means salvation. He's the Savior. He loves to save his people. He loves his people.
Amen.
Amen. So, Isaiah 54. It says, sing, O barren, who have not borne. Break forth into singing and cry aloud. You who have not labored with child, for more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman. So what's it saying here? It's saying that the woman who's barren is going to have more children than the woman that's not. That's grace. That's grace. It's something you don't deserve. It's something that, I can't do this by my... Look, everything in my life is... I'm trying to do this, but I'm not getting it. But you know what? Whenever you start singing, thank you, Lord, you finished the work. You start seeing that it's his grace, that you get what you don't deserve.
Amen.
See, the problem, we have this consciousness of, we mess up, and I'm like, man, look what I just did. I don't deserve God's goodness. I don't feel righteous. I don't feel loved. See, because we start putting ourselves focused on sin. Sin's past. Amen. It's gone. It's finished. Past, present, future. He took your sin and put it at the cross.
Amen.
He's given you the robe of righteousness. Yes. Why are we focused on the robe of unrighteousness? The robe of sin. See, that's what happens, you know. Wherever we have, this is the old jacket that Jesus, he took our sins. He took our place. We have his robe of righteousness now.
Right.
But sometimes we focus on this when this is paid.
Thank you, Jesus.
We need to see this.
Amen.
Thank you, Jesus. That, you know what? In this pocket, there's healing. In this pocket, oh, there's unmerited favor. There's grace. We start seeing him how God sees you.
Amen.
God doesn't see the sin anymore. He said, you know what? I will remember your sins no more. That's what God said. I will never be angry with you again. He swore those two things.
Amen.
Does God have to swear?
No,
he didn't. God doesn't have to swear. His word is truth. But he swears, I'll never be angry with you, and your sins I'll never remember no more. Never. And I will not cease from doing good to you. That's what God swears. Man, and he can't swear by anyone higher than himself. So God's like, I swear to God, I'll do this for you. That's the truth. That's the truth, though, okay? And so let's fast forward to this Isaiah. So let's go to Isaiah 54, actually verse 14. Verse 14, it's, in righteousness you shall be established. What is righteousness? I think
right
this is...
standing with God.
That's good. That's a good interpretation. Righteousness is like, I can look God eye to eye, and I have the same standing as he has. There's no guilt, no condemnation. There is all, you're all innocent and blameless. Because it's not your righteousness that you have on you. It's the righteousness of Jesus. So Jesus actually gave you his right standing so that you could stand right in front of God and say, wow, God, I'm blameless now because everything's paid. It's all past.
Amen.
Because of the cross. Actually, this morning, I was actually reading something that really touched my heart in John. It was actually something Jesus said, you know. I'll read it to you. It was John 17, verse 22 and 23. And the glory... Jesus is saying this prayer. He's at the Garden of Gethsemane. He's praying to his Father, and he's
say where you are again.
Oh, John 17, the Gospel of John. John 17, 22 and 23.
Thank you.
No problem. And that's John 17, 22, 23 for online too. And this is whenever Jesus was about to go to the cross. He went to the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. He was talking to his dad. It's like, you know what? Hey, Dad, and the glory which you gave me, I have given to them, that they may be one just as we are one. And I in them, and you in me, that they may be perfect in one, and that the world may know that you sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. That kind of blew my mind right there.
Wow.
That actually, Jesus is saying, wow, you love them just as the amount as you love me.
Wow.
That's why God sent his son. He sent his son because he loved you. You know what? He saw where we were. He saw me in my sins. He saw me how like much I needed a savior. And he loved me where I was before I even knew. Before he even died, he loved me. God sent his son because he loved you. That's amazing love to me. And he's given you this glory. This glory is righteousness on you. And it's the same righteousness that God has. Okay? So that's something that kind of really touched me. I was like, wow, I didn't know that. Oh, wow, Jesus, he just told me how much God the Father loves me the same as the amount as Jesus. That makes me feel good. You know what I mean? Like, because sometimes whenever I mess up, I don't feel righteous. I don't feel loved. I feel like disqualified. You know what I mean?
Amen.
But you know what? It's our very disqualification that is our qualification.
Amen.
Isn't that interesting? It's the area, oh wow, it's because Jesus took the sin and it's the free gift. Whoa, it kind of blows your mind a little bit of God's grace, God's love, that he's taken away the you shall not, and he said, I will put my laws in your minds. I will love you, and I will not cease from doing you good. That's God. He says, I will do this. I will do this. Not about you doing it. I'm going to take care of it, because the Ten Commandments was all about you. You can never do it.
That's right.
So Jesus came to fulfill the Ten, to give you grace. To be, Jesus is a man, 100% man, 100% God. As a man, he came for this one reason: to cut a covenant with God on our behalf, to make us beneficiaries. Because the first Adam, which sinned, which is in Romans 5:17, it says, for all death came through the one Adam. That way, through the one righteous act, all life could come to us. So through Jesus' righteous act, we can have his life now. It's kind of interesting. It's really interesting how like Jesus is the last Adam. Adam, the first Adam, brought about sin and death. Now Jesus, the last Adam, brings about life, because he said, I have come that they may have life and have it more abundantly.
Show them that scripture.
Oh, that's John 10.
Romans 5:17.
Oh, Romans 5:17?
Mm-hmm.
I quote that one so many times. It's actually one of my favorite verses. I quote Romans 5. Oh, I quoted it last week. I quote this one all the time.
Romans 5.
It's actually my favorite scripture, and it has two of my favorite numbers, 5 and 17. You know, 5, Matt, what's 5? Five is what? It's the number of grace. It's the fifth time Noah's name was mentioned in the Bible, he found grace in the eyes of the Lord. The fifth time David's name is mentioned, he found grace in the eyes of Saul. The fifth time Ruth's name is mentioned, she found favor in the sight of Boaz. 5 is the number of grace.
Amen.
The fifth letter in the Hebrew alphabet is actually, hey. It's like a breath. Hey. Whenever God breathed into man, hey, his grace went into us. The last thing that Jesus did at the cross, he gasped, hey. Grace. It's grace. He loves us. So, Romans 5:17. 17 is another number. I met the love of my life on the 17th day.
This is the girl.
Actually. And you know what? 17 actually means victory over all evil. Oh, that's a great number, isn't it? 17. Victory over all evil. On the 17th day in Genesis, if you read, whenever Noah's ark rested on the mountain of Ararat, it was on the 17th day. And you know what Ararat means? The curse has been reversed.
Amen.
So, because of the 17, the curse has been reversed. You know, Jesus rose on the 17th day of Nisan. The 17th day of Nisan was also the same day that the Red Sea was parted and they escaped from Egypt. 17, victory over all evil. There's even, whenever the Holy Spirit first fell, they spoke in 17 different languages. In Romans 8, whenever Paul's reciting, neither life nor death, nor principalities nor powers, nor this nor that. This 17 things. Because nothing can ever separate you from his love.
Well,
because of the
Jesus.
Of the victory at the
Amen.
Cross. That's all numbers. I love numbers. So, not the book, but actual numbers. And so Romans 5:17. It's my two favorite numbers. I think God just kind of like loves to throw those at me. Hey, here's grace and victory over all evil because of grace. And it says, for if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive an abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness will reign in life through the one, Jesus Christ. You know, I study a little bit harder than your average guy because I'm a pastor and you kind of have to. So whenever I was reading this, I actually go to where it says, Those who receive,
yeah.
In the, whenever you look at it from the Greek, like if you're taking it all the way apart, it's actually the present participle active voice. So that means you're presently actively receiving. So it's something we have to do continually to have this life through Jesus Christ, this amazing life, the life that reigns. How do we receive? I thought I already got the righteousness. I got it one time. Yeah, once for all.
I hear you.
So, no, wherever you believe, you get the righteousness. Wherever you get saved, you're sealed. So how do I keep on getting more and more righteousness? How?
By believing.
Well, it is a word. It's actually when you speak. Because the righteousness of faith speaks. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. No weapon formed against me shall prosper, because I deserve that, but I'm getting what I don't deserve. Your favor, your blessings, your grace. When you speak it. The problem is in the body of Christ is we hear we're saved and we have this righteousness, but we never say it. We never say, oh, because we know what we say. Oh man, I messed up. I'm out of God's graces today until I make it to Sunday. Whenever, you know what God says? Nothing will separate you from his love. Amen. Nothing can get you out of God's good graces, because Jesus took it all at the cross.
Amen.
Amen. Nothing can separate you from him.
Amen.
You have the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Can the Holy Spirit pop in and out?
No.
That's kind of psycho, right? I mean, that would mean righteousness is always going in and out of you whenever it says you have the gift once for all.
Amen.
Jesus said, my sheep hear my voice. And you know what? They're in my hand. And no one is able to snatch them out of my hand.
And a stranger's voice they will not follow.
Well, actually, after that it says, if that's not enough, my Father's hand is on top of my hand. And no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand. That's how sealed you are. That's how sealed. In righteousness, in love, in blessings, in God's goodness, and God's good graces, you're so sealed, not even you can get yourself out of God's hands, okay? I mean, can you move the unmovable? Can you shake the unshakable? No, we can't. So once you're in there forever. And it's all by, Jesus, I need a Savior. I need you to be my Savior for life. Please, Jesus, I believe that you did it. I believe that you died for my sins. Boom. Sealed.
Amen.
Amen. So, but whenever we start speaking, some of the best way to keep on receiving these things, to possess our possessions, is through speech. Whenever we speak, hey, today's going to be a good day today, because God is for me. He's not against me.
Amen.
Because you know what? What is hope? Bible hope is different than world hope. World hope says, oh, I hope this is going to happen. I hope. Bible hope?
Confident expectation of good.
That's right. Confident expectation of good. It's actually the Greek word elpis. And if you look at the definition, it means a confident expectation of good.
Amen.
Now, oh, God is doing this not because I deserve it. It's because Jesus deserves it, and he's taken my place, and I've taken his place. We cut a covenant. Okay? That's actually a whole nother sermon. All right. So let's actually go back to Romans 10. Romans 10. So this is, I always thought whenever I was a young Christian, whenever I was a young believer, I used to read this, and I used to always think that this is a salvation verse. Romans 10 verse, let's go to Romans 10 verse 9. If you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart, God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved, right? You always, you think that's a salvation verse, right?
Mm-hmm.
Do you know that that word confess is not confess your sins? It's confess that Jesus is your righteousness. Because back in those days, and whenever the first of the church came about, they would say, oh yeah, Lord Jesus, yeah, that he's my Savior. That, whenever they would say that, their meaning, Jesus is my righteousness. They're saying it aloud. The word saved there is not the word sozo. Not the word sozo. It's the word soteria. Okay? In Greek, soteria, it means a material and temporal deliverance from danger and oppression.
Wow.
A temporal. Not something we get later. It's actually a physical deliverance. Salvation. That's the word there in the Greek. It's soteria, not sozo. So whenever we start saying, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus, you know what? The devil's fleeing, because he's like, I can't mess with someone who's walking by faith. I can't mess with someone who's being just, who sees that it's faith righteousness. I can't mess with them. He can't. Because he has to depart, because he can't. He sees you as you're established in it.
Amen.
Because you start to see, oh, wait. You're saying it's about Jesus. He can't mess with you then. Because you know what happened to the devil at the cross? This is actually pretty funny. He got a PhD. Permanent head damage. Okay. You know why? Because whenever Jesus was at the cross, his heel was bruised, but he crushed the Satan's head. And you know what? That's why he's got permanent head damage. Okay. And you know what? He only goes after your head. He tries to put thoughts in your mind. Why are we listening to a guy who has permanent head damage in our mind? Get out of here, devil. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ.
Amen.
No weapon formed against me shall prosper. God has good for me.
Amen.
I'm a child of Abraham.
Amen.
Abraham was blessed with much silver, gold, and many, many lands, and many, many flocks.
Amen.
Amen. That's Abraham's blessing.
That's right.
Amen. And we have that same blessing because we're under Christ's seed. The seed is the heir through Christ. See, this is something I always talking about. See, if Shevin's my wife, that means she is joint heir with me, right? A joint heir. In Romans 8, it says that we've become joint heirs with Christ. A joint heir. So if I have a bunch of stuff, can she just go to the fridge and eat something out of the fridge? Or, is it not hers? See, the point is, if you're a joint heir, it's all the same. You own it.
Yeah.
You own what Jesus owns because you're a joint heir with Christ.
Amen.
What he has, you have. He has blessings. He has divine health. You got it.
Amen.
Amen.
But the problem is, even Jesus said this. He said, you know what? You ask not, that's why you have not. And you believe, he said, whenever you ask for things, believe that you already have them, and then you'll receive them. See, it's all by, I believe that it's already here, and then it starts to manifest. Because humans are, we get like Thomas, doubting Thomas. I will only believe if Jesus comes here in the flesh and shows me his hands. That's what he said.
Yeah.
He said that. He wasn't there that day whenever Jesus showed up. He was out. And then the disciples tried to tell him. He was like, I'm not going to believe unless Jesus actually lets me put my hands in his scars. He's like, why are you, you know what? He said, blessed are those who have not seen, but believed.
Amen.
That's what, blessed are the people that haven't seen it, but already believe that it's theirs.
Amen.
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 That's what Jesus said.
That's right.
I'm quoting the good book. Okay. Amen.
Amen.
So, as I was saying, I think I was in Isaiah 54. Isaiah 54. Sorry if I'm going fast online. I'm just kind of excited. Excited about Jesus. Isaiah 54. This is actually something that, you know, God was showing me. In righteousness you shall be established. This is Isaiah 54, verse 14. Isaiah 54, verse 14. In righteousness you shall be established, and you shall be far from oppression. Whenever you start seeing that it's, I'm the righteous by faith. I'm righteous because it's Jesus' righteousness. You're far from oppression. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Everyone say that. I am the righteousness of God in Christ. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. See, the more we say it, the more we believe it. Oh, it gives you a warm feeling inside.
Amen.
And from the terror, for it shall not come near you. The terror will not come near you when you're established in righteousness. Whenever you start saying, I'm the righteous of God in Christ, it drives the evil away.
Amen.
Amen. And indeed, they shall surely assemble, but not because of me. Whoever assembles against you shall fall for your sake. Isn't that great? Whenever the devil's arming up a big army against you, they're going to fall. Because, you know what? You have the righteousness of God in you. You have his divine protection. You have his divine righteousness, his divine health. I'm in Isaiah 54, verse 15.
Okay, bye.
Isaiah 54, verse 15. Behold, I have created the blacksmith who blows the coals of fire in the fire, who brings forth an instrument for his work, and I have created the spoiler to destroy. This is one of the best verses. It's actually another 17. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. Jesus, he's saying, weapons are going to form, they'll form against you, but they won't have victory over you.
Amen.
They won't prosper against you.
Amen.
There's weapons. We see that. There's nuclear weapons. Sometimes there's even like, we get sick or something, or we see a pain. Let me tell you, it won't prosper because of Christ. Amen. Because he's with you. He's in you. You have his divine health. You have it. Start possessing it. Thank you, Jesus. I'm the righteous of God in Christ Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. I have your divine health. Thank you, Jesus. I have your victory to reign over every area of my life. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, so, and then he's like, and every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn. Tongues rise against us in judgment sometimes. It's usually in your own head. It's always in my own head. Look what you just did. Why are you afraid, Zach? Why are you thinking that way? What are you doing? You know, it's all this condemnation, this judgment, that sometimes I just say, no, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. be gone in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
And you know what usually departs? Because you know what? It's just the devil screwing with you. Because you know what? He only goes after people that are alive. He wants to shut up that life that he sees sprouting. Because he knows it's just a matter of time before God's grace blows through this thing and really just sets it on grace train. Amen. And it says, this is the heritage, the inheritance of the servants of the Lord. And their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. And their righteousness is from me. You get that? It's all from Jesus. It's his righteousness for you. Not because of what we do, because of what he did.
Amen.
Amen. See, I remember whenever I was first learning this stuff, it was like music to my ears. I was like, wow, this is pretty good. Thank you, Jesus. Yeah. Wow, you did it all. My whole life, I thought, well, man, I'm not holy enough to be rolling with these people. I don't go to church enough. You know, I was always judging myself based on my performance. Whenever Jesus says, you know what? No, you stand on grace ground now. There's no condemnation. It's not because of you. It's because of him. See,
amen.
Even John the Baptist said this. He says, I must decrease, he must increase. See, whenever we start decreasing, saying, you know what? It's not about me. It's about Jesus. He finished the work. What could I ever do?
Amen.
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 Do you know that God the Father spoke two times in the Bible for everyone to hear? For everyone to hear. I love this. The first time, whenever he first started his ministry, he was 30 years old. And he went to the River Jordan, and John the Baptist baptized him. And the Father opened up the heaven and said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased. Before Jesus ever did one miracle, before he ever did one thing good, God said, this is my beloved Son, in whom I'm well pleased.
Amen. Amen.
At the lowest, you know, that Dead Sea area, the Jordan, is one of the lowest parts of the earth. You know what? It doesn't matter if you're at the lowest part of yourself and you feel the worst. God says, you're my beloved child, in whom I'm well pleased. The second time God spoke openly was on Mount Hermon. It's one of the highest mountains in Israel. It doesn't matter if you're at the highest or the lowest and you feel like it that way. He says, you're my beloved child in whom I'm well pleased.
Amen.
Amen. Isn't that good? Isn't that good? I love it because we all have highs and lows. Sometimes you're feeling low. But you know what? That's why sometimes we come to church, because another person's at a high and they're going to say, hey, remember who you are. Remember you're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Remember you're blessed. Remember you're loved. And that pulls you up, don't it? Amen. Amen. It makes you feel good. It makes you feel good because we start remembering our identity. Our identity that is in Christ. Amen?
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. So, I wrote down a couple things. You know, it said, today, live with the fact that Jesus got all that you deserve at the cross. What I deserve is to be on that cross, nailed and scourged. That's what we deserve. That's the price of sin. The wages of sin is death. So today, expect to get everything you don't deserve. Think, have in your mind, oh, God, where are you going to bless me today? Oh, man, your goodness and mercy is hunting me down today. I don't know where it's coming, but it's coming. Because you know what? I don't deserve it. You're right. That's right. It's true. I mean, amen. Because you're righteous by faith. It's a gift. It's a gift. And see, this is... righteousness is a big part of grace. We have to know that we're righteous from Christ. Grace, it's all the gift of God. It's grace, right, Matt?
Yeah.
Grace, grace. Amen. Remember, one of my favorite persons in the Bible, Zechariah, similar name. And, you know, he told Zerubbabel, shout grace, grace to that mountain, and it shall become a plain. Amen. Shout grace, grace. Amen. Sometimes there's mountains. We see a mountain in our life. We see a giant. And we get afraid. We're like, I don't know how I'm going to handle this. I don't know how I'm going to do this. Shout grace, grace, because Jesus already handled it at the cross. He handled it for you because he wants you to be seated. He wants you to rest. I think, you know, there's so many things I can blow your mind with. But it's seeing that it's the payment's done for the things that come against us. It's seeing that the victory's won. Instead of focusing on what can I, we say, he shall supply.
Amen.
Amen. Instead of what do I have to do? Why do I have to get this? No. He shall supply all your needs according to the riches of his grace. He shall supply. He shall supply. Where is God going to hit me today? Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Okay. And I think I was just talking about something. Do you know, I was saying, this is something cool right here. You know that I started off saying that church is not for a place for perfect people. And a great example we can go to, let's go to 1 Samuel 22. 1 Samuel 22.
1 Samuel 22.
That's right.
1 Samuel.
He's next to 2 Samuel. Next to Ruth, I believe. It's Ruth. Yeah, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel. Joshua, Judges, Ruth, 1 Samuel.
I'll get it. I got it.
All right, that's online. That's 1 Samuel 22, verse 1. All right. This is one of our favorite people in the Bible. I think if everybody's ever heard or read the Bible, you know David, right? David and Goliath. Uh-huh. David. Do you know what his name means in Hebrew? It means beloved. Beloved. That's the Hebrew definition for David. Because you know what? You're his beloved. Whenever he said, the father said, this is my beloved son, and I'm all pleased. We're joint heirs with Christ. We're his beloved, right?
Yeah.
Okay? And David was afraid. Hey, heroes get afraid too, okay? They're not perfect. David wasn't, and neither are we. And you know what? He departed from, you know what? The king of Gath actually had him chained up, and he pretended madness for a couple days. He just had drools going down, and then he departed. They let him go, and he ran. He ran away. And then it says in verse 1 of chapter 22, David therefore departed from there and escaped to the cave of Adullam. So when his brothers and all his father's house heard it, they went down there to him. And everyone who was in debt and distress, and everyone who was in debt, and everyone who was discontented gathered to him. And he became a captain over them. There were about 400 men. You know who these 400 guys became? They became the mighty men of David. They killed giants. Giants came up. One guy killed Adino, the guy whose name means sat in the seat. He actually killed 800 men at one time. But you know what? How did he start out? He started out a person that just gathered to David. Gathered at church, feeling like, oh man, debt is driving me here. I don't know what to do. Only God can help. Right?
Right.
People don't, you know what? We see these some people in church and we think, wow, how are these people so mighty? They're, you know, like the Billy Grahams and the people, man, really think, man, I can't compare to that. People never start like that. They start like this, in distress, very distressed, very in debt, and they all gather together and God grows his mighty men.
Amen.
He grows them because we start learning.
Right.
This is actually where God showed me a hidden thing, you know. I think I'll maybe close on this. There's hidden things in the Bible, hidden things that are amazing. The first letter of the Hebrew alphabet is actually the letter Aleph. And the last letter of the Hebrew alphabet is the letter Tav. So,
tell them where the Hebrew alphabet is.
I'm about to get there.
Psalm 91.
I'm about to get there. Well, first.
Psalm 91.
So, throughout the entire Old Testament, if you go looking, you're going to see two little letters mistranslated. They're not translated ever. It's the first letter and the last letter. The Jews, the people who have this Bible, they can't explain it. They don't have the interpretation for it. But you know what? We do. Because you know what? In Revelation, John spoke to Jesus. Jesus said, I'm the Alpha and I'm the Omega. That's the first and the last. But he wouldn't have said that to a Jew. He would have spoke Hebrew. He would have said, I am the Aleph and I am the Tav. I'm the first and I'm the last. The first letter, all their letters, they have a picture that goes with it. The first letter is a picture of an ox or a lamb. That's the actually, if you go look and back in the history of it, every Jewish person knows this, every Hebrew person knows this, that the first letter of the Hebrew alphabet is a picture of a lamb. The last letter of the Hebrew alphabet is a picture of the cross. That's Jesus' signature right there. I'm the Lamb on the cross. I'm the Lamb that took away the sin of the world. I'm the one who paid it.
Amen.
And the first verse of the Bible, it's in there. It's the third. There's six letters in the first in the Hebrew language in the first verse of the Bible. And in the center, right, there's three here, right in the center, Aleph Tav. Because he's in the center of mankind. He wants to be in the center of your life. Him in the cross, Jesus in the cross. Amen. Amen? Every Hebrew letter has a numeric value, a numeric number. It's just like our numbers. The one for Aleph is one. It's the first letter. The numeric value is one. For Tav, it's 400. So you got 1 and 400. God showed me this hidden. If you read right here, it says that he became captain over them, and there were 400 men gathered. So you got 1 David, 400 men. That's a hidden Aleph Tav in the scriptures. That's a hidden Jesus in the cross. Isn't that amazing? I think I love numbers. I don't know. It's neat. It's neat when God, he drops little things in your head and right there for you. Just like, oh, look, hey, don't forget it's about me. Don't forget that every story is about me. Don't forget that from the beginning, it's about Jesus at the cross. Amen?
Amen.
It's from the beginning. It's always been like he was the lamb that was offered up for Adam and Eve. He's the one who died to get them clothed. He's the one that, you know what, Abel offered up that same lamb saying, oh, it's not my performance. Like Cain. Cain thought, oh, look, I do so good, God will bless me. God said, no. Take the lamb. It's a free gift. Offer it up. He loves it whenever you see it's about Jesus.
Amen.
Amen. God is so pleased whenever you start saying, I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. Because you know what? You see value in the Son.
His righteousness.
His righteousness is right. But you see value in the work. You see value in the payment. You see value in the perfect work of Jesus. Amen? And that just makes God the Father pleased. He's like, whoa, they see it. They see it that Jesus was sent for. He was sent for you. He died for you. And they, you see the work. It's perfect. It's finished. Amen? I think that's all we'll touch on today. Amen? That was a lot. I don't know. I get fired up and it's kind of hard to stop. You know, whatever. Because the Bible has so many things that are just like hidden mysteries. So many things about the love of God for us. And I'm gonna end by saying a prayer. Saying a prayer for you guys. All right. Thank you, Lord, for this day. Thank you, Lord, that you know these people that have gathered that are in person and online. And I want you to keep on reminding them that they're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. Keep on reminding them to speak it aloud whenever they feel discouraged. Speak it aloud whenever they feel afraid. Speak it aloud. Because you know what? It's all about your Son. And bless them. If they're in a financial situation, turn it around. If they're in a feeling pains in their bodies, make it stop in Jesus' name. This week that goes ahead, Father, shower nothing but the goodness and mercies that hunt them down every day of this week. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Oh yeah, and I always do this at the end. It's sinner's prayer. And if you haven't accepted Jesus to be your Savior, and maybe you want this abundant life, you want this Jesus, you want this to be a son, just say these words with me. Father, I believe that Jesus died for my sins on the cross, that he was raised again, and because of his raise, he was raised and my sins are gone and paid for, I'm now righteous and I'm a son. Thank you, Jesus, that you paid the price for my life. Are my Savior. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thank you, guys.
Amen. Hey, do y'all want to do some praise and worship? We did a few songs before y'all got here because we're y'all ready.